So this is what I do every single day. I'm a user experience designer. And I'll give you a little bit about my background first so you can understand where I came from and where I'm going. So I have about 20 years of design experience. Starting back in 1998, before I graduated from college, I was during the first dot-com boom, I was actually going to school for print design. You guys know the magazines and books and everything. They actually had designers that did print for the longest time. And I went to school for that, and I decided this web thing is way cooler than print materials. So even before I graduated school, I was doing websites and web design for the first dot-com. And I graduated, and I started to do more and more and more, and I quit print, probably about 2 years out of school. So I was just doing focused on the web. And the web was such a cool place. Applications were starting to get cooler and cooler. So I had a graphic design background. I was applying to the web. And I started working at agencies and doing a lot of client work. So I was working with John Deere, Disney, ABC, movie company, the Honeywell, and lots of big brand names, doing a lot of cool projects. Some were boring, some were cool. But most of them were fun projects to do, R&D, a lot of cool stuff. But I was a little bit of everywhere. I wasn't focused on one product. So about 2 years ago, I started to focus on IoT and mobile software, and I worked at SmartThings for about 2 years, and Samsung, and worked on some cool projects there. And now I'm currently at Arlo security cameras. Are you guys familiar with Arlo at all? Security cameras are wire-free cameras that will detect motion, and yeah, it's a night vision as well. Completely wire-free. And so now I'm focused more on the products. So some of the cool projects that I've worked on, one of them was Disney. I helped do R&D to create Disney Life, which is a Disney branded like kind of subscription service. It's not here in the US, but it's in the UK right now. So that was a fun project to work with. Then Afterlife, which I don't have a picture in here due to some NDAs, is actually a way to bring back old ABC shows online. And we helped kind of develop the next version of Fuller House at that point. Anybody watch Fuller House? Jesus. Come on. Okay. That's okay. So at Samsung and SmartThings, I worked on TV as a hub. So I got to work with the Korea team, went to Korea, started developing the smart home and part of the TV. It was launched at CES about a year and a half ago. Unfortunately, they've decided to discontinue it only because TVs draw very little power. It's energy-consuming, very energy-saving device, and you have something that's consuming maybe up to 300 different types of IoT products that can draw a lot more energy when the TV's supposed to be off. So it was not what I would say a great product. Had a lot of bad use cases, but it was cool and fun to work on as well. And the current thing I'm working on right now for Arlo is a pet tracker. So it's going to be similar in the vein of Whistle or some other GPS trackers you guys might use. And that's about all I can show on that right now. So that's all you get.
Gotta love NDAs.
Yeah, what's that?
Gotta love NDAs.
Yeah, a lot of NDAs. Yeah, you get to see all that's it. So let's talk about user experience design. So what is user experience design? What it is I do. And user experience designer, the responsibility of user experience designers is, of course, for just understand users and what do users do. And users are human, and they have a changing set of behaviors, preferences, and goals. So any product that you see that's out there today, companies come up with assumptions. Those assumptions are, user wants to do X, and they want to do it this way. And what user experience designers do, we come in to kill the party. We come in and say, your assumptions are only assumptions, we need to test all this stuff. And we need to see if users really want that. And once you get this kind of crossroads of assumptions and testing, you kind of get the product that you might end up with today. It might not be a great product, but at least you know better about what the user really wants out of a product at the end of the day. So, now we kind of know what UX is, let's talk a little bit about the UX process and how we understand what users really want. The UX process can be done multiple different ways, but there's usually a set way of doing things for whatever a project. And usually a product is launched, and in the case of like Arlo video cameras, usually a product manager or product some business application, we decide that we're going to launch a new device, a new camera, a new product. And there's usually some business objective, some business goal, like either we want to make money. You know, that's what companies want to do. They want to make money. And we find a way to say, well, we want to make money. The product wants all these bells and whistles. And the user wants this. So this is kind of like this big Venn diagram. I don't have it, but you guys know what Venn diagrams are. Users over here and the product people and all their cool ideas. And then there's business objectives. And somewhere in the middle, we have to find the sweet spot that what everybody wants. It's not easy. You have to tug and pull a little bit. But the process that we go into find this kind of Venn diagram to make it a nice sweet spot for users is, you know, these really five critical bullet points. There's a sixth one I'll show you in a bit. But the first part is design, discovery, and planning. And discovery and planning is really the business objectives. What we get is UX designers and product people, what it is we're trying to achieve. The planning is kind of assumption-based, what we think users want. Users want a video camera, they want it to do this, they want motion, they want it to have night vision, they want to have this. We get these requirements, and all these requirements are tied to the business objective in some way. And after we're done with discovery and planning, we do research and strategy. And the research and strategy is important because that's when we start to get UX researchers. And I'm a UX designer, that's different. UX researchers really take look at all the business objectives we're trying to do, and they say, let's look at the cameras. Now let's go to see the competitors. What are the competitors doing? And then we go talk to users. What do users really want out of a camera? What is it they're really looking for out of a camera? You know, in the case of Rob, thank you. Robin, in your case, sorry, I'm going to bring it over here. You're looking for someone, a camera to help solve a problem that somebody might be stealing something off your front porch. That is called a job to be done. And Robin has a job to be done. User UX designers, we have jobs to be done. So we take all these business objectives, we take all these product requirements, and we say these are the jobs to be done for the user. A user is going to check the app, the mobile app, to see if they have any video clips for the day for motion detection. And we take these objectives and we make sure we go to the user. Is this a job you really want to do? So under that research and strategy part is where we go talk to everybody. And then we come back and say, boy, product, you guys are really off, or you're not going to make much money at what you're doing. Here's what we recommend. And then the next part is conceptual design and wireframing. And conceptual design and wireframing is really kind of going to the whiteboard and coming down with ideas of how this is going to work with a current app or a new app. And wireframing is really basic way to describe what it is that's going to happen in the app. And I'll show you these examples as well in just a second. And then there's the high fidelity design, which is after everything's said and done, we've got a product, we know it's going to, we got work, we've got user research, we know that people are going to want to be excited about this, we've got some feedback already, now we put the high fidelity design. So this is the final polish and design polish we put on the app before it launches. And from there, that's like I said, the last 10% is really kind of a glossy coating to make it look pretty. And then we launch. And it either goes great or it goes great. But all these areas have an iterative process. So every single place we do it, research strategy, conceptual design, we iterate until we get it right. User testing. We might not have, people might not understand the color of a button and what it does. People might not understand I can click here. Oh, people might not understand what this product or this terminology means. So we keep going and going and going until we get it right. And then we keep going, and then we get better and better, and then we kind of look at how we can make it better for the user. We put it back in user testing, we can create prototypes. And so our prototypes are mobile apps that are just like screens. And then users can tap on it and show us how we're doing wrong, making wrong decisions. We're making right decisions. But at the same time, even after we launch, we're not done. Design is never done. It is never done. You can apply that to anything. So you can always make it better. You can revise, you can make it faster, you can make it simpler, you're gonna be easier to use. But it's good once you launch and you think you have maybe, you think it's really good. We launch it, we get it out there, we get feedback from users, we get more responses, we get good feedback, we get bad feedback, we get, ooh, I want this, this is what I really want. And then you keep going with the product cycle. So now I talked about the UX process a little bit. So I'm gonna kind of show you each of these pieces of the process and how I've applied it to my current work today. So I'm gonna give you an example when I was at SmartThings. We worked on a video player, and the video player was, we were integrating Arlo cameras or other cameras that are out there. So actually, any camera that we had, we run with SmartThings. Are you guys familiar with SmartThings? Mm-hmm. SmartThings is an Internet of Things platform. It supports about 300 different Internet of Things devices, so moisture sensors and motion sensors and door locks and Amazon, Alexa or Echo and cameras, and kind of this hub that will kind of like HomeKit, if you guys are familiar with HomeKit. And so what we did is try to work on the video player. So this is not SmartThings. I just grabbed this off Google because I want to give an example of what the UX research looks like. This is kind of it. UX research can be done in multiple different ways, but this is kind of how you see people. We actually have this room at Netgear, so we'll sit behind the glass and we'll watch users and we give them these jobs to be done. We give them user and say, here's your task, here's what you need to do. And they talk it out and tell us, we don't give them any other advice, we just watch them perform the task. We try not to be biased in anything we do, because we just say, hey, why don't you tap on the home icon, and people are starting to look for a home icon. We've already been biased in our research. So what we do is we sit down the user to do tasks and have them perform the task, and then we grade the task and how well they did it. And then we get the user feedback on how was their task fully performed, did you have troubles? Where did you have trouble? We take all this data, we take it back, and we use it to make a better mobile app, a better product. You know, for example, we have a Wi-Fi mesh network called Orbi, and Orbi is this kind of, I don't know, you guys know about the mesh networks that are out today. Google Home has one, and so the mesh network has this LED light on it, and we had issues with the LED light. People didn't understand what the LED light meant in certain phases, and then it disappeared after you installed it and it was never used again. And so we had a lot of users get confused on a LED light. They weren't paying attention to the mobile app, they were looking at this light. And so we got really good feedback from users on this research that we should probably be paying more attention to having the light do more things for the user. And that came out of a study of, I think, about 6 users. So even the smallest set of research you can do for your product, that will bring back some really powerful data for you. Even if it's, you know, not exactly what you think would be a large amount of data or a lot of people, that represents probably a bigger, greater mass of the people that would engage with your product in the future. So, conceptual design and wireframing, design and planning. Before I even go anywhere to the computer, we go into a room with product and every stakeholder, and we go on the whiteboard and we do whiteboard sessions. And they can be days, they can be weeks. We can go in and we can argue. There's a lot of arguing about who has the right idea. And those are all assumptions. So what we try to do is we go in there and we get sticky notes. We love sticky notes. And they make a better movable thing because you can move stuff around and go, yeah, they need to go this way. And in this case, we're doing the video. This is actually what I did for our user experience for the video. When I was doing it, it was a bigger board, there's a lot more stuff. This is just a zoomed in feature. But from there on, the blue sticky note is a notification, and then what the user gets from a notification, how they jump into the app when they get a video clip was received. And we kind of work from there, and we start doing these jobs to be done. And there we have use cases. So we define use cases for every product. And these set of defining use cases, these jobs to be done, user receives notification, and these video clip, we need to somehow represent that, how the user is going to do it. So engineering can build it, and product can say that one's going to work, and the business objectives are met at that point. So once we're done with this and we know, okay, this is how we're going to do things, we start taking things to the wireframe. And so in this one, this is a user views live camera in the room view detail. I think this document was roughly about 100 pages long, but it included a lot of screens like this. It's very boring, but important for all the engineers to know, okay, I even put down all the descriptions of all the interaction design that's going to happen. So if the user goes to tap on the room there, and they get to the camera, when they usually hit the play button, there becomes a spinner to let you know that we are loading the camera, the video, and then the camera starts to play. I know it seems very simple. Everybody doesn't think about that, but for UX designers, we have to think about all the error cases. So we think about the golden path. The golden path is what's the best experience. The best experience is your video is going to play, because when it doesn't play, people get mad. But what happens when it doesn't play? Well, you get errors. And errors, we have to document all the error handling. Oh my gosh, there's no Wi-Fi. Well, how do you tell the user that? Oh my gosh, well, there's no video. What happened? Okay, so you got to tell the user. And then you got to give the user some sort of way out. Retry again, or this way. This is all documented. And it sounds really boring. But it's so important that engineers have everything covered, because what happens is the UX designer or anybody comes after and says, hey, we've designed all this stuff, but what happens if that doesn't work? We have to think about all these use cases, and we document them all. But the real fun part comes of making a core experience that users have fun and they enjoy. So this is the wireframe stage, and then this is the high fidelity stage. So after all has been done, all the wireframes have been approved, we know the experience is going to work. Now we start putting the final polish on the last 10%. So on the left-hand side there, you can kind of see the GUI. That's the video GUI that we have that overlays it. You guys are used to YouTube, so you know that when you tap on it, the video GUI, the layover, comes up and shows. So this is the video GUI. We have two different types. We have I think the one at the top is just a playing from a clip, and the one at the bottom is actually a live video recording, so a live, watching the camera live. And then we make sure we document all these states and all the visual design language that we can. So it's kind of the whole UX process in a nutshell, which is it's fun. It is fun. Don't make it sound like, I'm not going to be trying to make it sound like it's boring. There's a lot of critical thinking that goes into it. And at the end of the day, you come out with some really cool products and you learn a lot of cool stuff about users. And it's fun to do. So that's kind of what I do. Now let's talk about some UX awesomeness and jobs to be done. So I just want to talk about some cool user experience that's out in the world today that you guys might see daily and you might not think about. And one of my favorite things to talk about is this. You guys know this, right? Calculator on the right-hand side and your phone. But does anybody know why the numbers are arranged differently?
History.
What's that?
History.
History. Explain.
So you go back to like the number pad on your keyboard,
yes,
which comes from, like, I assume the way it was arranged on typewriters at some point, or you go back to like the way I probably Bell Labs created the touch tone phone, like they were arranged differently in those two cases.
Yeah, you're on the nose. So absolutely right. The calculator, of course, came before the touch tone phone. And I'm going to talk about the Bell Labs thing because it's one of my favorite things about user experience and history that I've ever seen. That most people today don't think about this as being, but you're right, on the keyboard, IBM, data entry, you know, was hot with calculators and people were doing data entry. And when the touch tone phone, Bell Labs went from this, any of you guys used this before? Yeah, so many people. Yeah. Rotary phones were pretty dick. But it had a meaning. You know, everything had a way that it would work. So Bell Labs went over to the touch tone phone. And so they actually called the people that created the calculator and said, why did you come up with this numbering system? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, the way you did. And they had no research behind it. They had just done it and put it together on keyboards and calculators, and they had never really thought about why they did it. There was no research to back it up at all. So Bell Labs decided, let's do research. Let's go ask users what it is they really like. Let's not assume, let's not make assumptions. Let's actually go to users. So this is in the 1960s. Bell Labs went through, and you can kind of see all the different types of user, you know, from something as simple as 9 numbers plus a 0. They put in all these different patterns. and they got a bunch of feedback from users, and they really liked the pattern in the upper left-hand corner. And so they started nailing and drilling it down for more research, more studies. They even have, you can kind of see in the liner notes there, keying time in seconds and percent of errors and ranking for this and ranking against. So you had, they talked to all these users, they had them go and do it. But they really realized is the job to be done is different. Data entry is completely different than calling your mom. This is not the same thing. So they realized that they came out with a better, you know, the form and the function of it is completely different than a calculator. So you can kind of see right there, the final two was this kind of horizontal grid down below. That could have been our touch tone phone you have seen. The app would have looked probably a little different than it does today. And up above is the one that actually won out. And the critical piece about this, the reason why that 1, 2, 3 landed, won out so much, is because of the fact that they have ABC, the alphabet, tied to each of the numbers. So when you think about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, the way we read from left to right in English, that 1, 2, 3 on the top left-hand corner was going to read for ABC all the way down to Z and 0 at the bottom. So give them something like that. A kudos. Yep.
Not yet.
But now you'll never look at a calculator or a phone ever again the same way, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, there's that funny rotary phone. Okay. The other thing I want to talk about is Disney. Who here likes Disney? More people who doesn't like Disney. I think Disney is probably the best user experience out there. Can you know why it's the best user experience?
Because
you're going to pay an arm and a leg to stand in a line for 90 minutes to ride on a ride. Who else would do that? Would you pay Amazon more money to have your box shipped later? No, but you would do that at Disney, wouldn't you? Am I going to stand in line for 90 minutes so I can go on this 5-second ride? Disney is the ultimate master of user experience, and we should be looking at this every day. When you're talking about they embrace new technology, they optimize user experience. That queue is one thing. When you walk through a Disney queue, it's much different than going through a Great American queue. You guys can probably tell that. You're much more bored in the Great American queue than you would be at, say, Disneyland. And they deliver unexpected moments of magic. Have you guys been to Disney World at all and used the magic bands? Did you guys know that when at the end of some rides, your name will pop up on displays? Like and you don't even have to scan your thing. They just know you're there. That's creepy, yes. It's delivered on these moments of unexpected magic that makes Disney who they are. And I'm not just kind of puffing them up and touting them because I did work with them, but when I did work with them, I was very constrained on everything I did. And all these VPs would be like, stop constraining yourself. We're Disney, we can do anything. So I said, well, I don't think we can do that on the Apple. And they're like, we know Steve Jobs, we can do anything. So we'll make it work. So the thinking without constraints of technology is one thing that Disney does really well. But at the same time, they want to have a user experience that is unique for users that will give them moments of these delight and expectations. So they use data to inform decision. That's all about UX. We use data to inform every decision we make. Even though it's an assumption, we want to use data to back everything up that we do. And then, of course, there's balance accessibility with exclusivity. And you want to give people access to all cool stuff, but also have this thing that's unique only for Disney. So that's how they mastered UX. So if you ever want to, some people don't like Disney, and I can relate with that. Nobody wants to stand in lines too long. But at the same time, I appreciate Disney and all they do because they make everything kind of fun. But that's it. Any questions? Yes.
So you said that you collect data. So do you guys collect surveys or what kind of surveys would you guys conduct then?
All sorts of data. So we do surveys. Surveys is one way of collecting. I'm not a UX researcher, so I'm not going to comment on all the different ways that you can do it. But surveys is one way to collect data. We can also collect data from in the current app today. So we have the qualitative and the quantitative data, but we try to do a little bit of both. So the data that we have from the app today really tells a story about where people are, what are they using, and how much they're using it. But it doesn't tell the story of why they're using it. Is it bad? Are they going down the wrong route? So that's where the surveys come into play. Like, so we get all this great data from the apps that we can use to say that people are using this library feature a lot. Like 10 million users are using it a day. Why are they using it? We don't know that. Let's go talk to users. So the surveys and the user research helps us dive down to these people, these core users, of why are you using the library this way? And then we use these two sets of data to kind of come with our next. So surveys is one. The data that's, you know, Google Analytics or anything that's embedded into the app. And then we also use in-house. We go into people's house. We study them there, how they use it, because people are comfortable in their home. They do things differently than what they do in a closed room. You saw the closed room. People perform based on what they think you want them to do, rather than what we want them to do, which is just to be, you know, human. Do your thing. So, yeah. So there's multiple different types of surveys you can do, too. I can't give you all the different details in there, but we try to do both qualitative and quantitative data. Any other questions?
Okay, so as a UX designer, do you do coding of some sort?
Coding?
Yeah.
If I need to, HTML, CSS,
okay. JavaScript.
Yeah, any JavaScript, YouTube, for prototyping. There are a lot of good prototyping tools out there that really make it easier for me to do. So I don't do as much coding as I did before, but, you know, like Envision is one. You can create tools and then drag them in and you have a full prototype. It's a handy thing to have, though, is to have a programming language of some sort as a background, so you can actually talk to engineers. We're working right now with the mobile designers to learn Xcode better, so that we can go in and fix any Apple or iOS apps and change colors or do anything we want to. So it's not a prerequisite, but it's always recommended.
There's a difference between UI and UX, right? So.
Yeah, so user experience is really the whole, encompassing the whole experience. And we know UI is really the software layer at the end of the day, but we look at hardware as UX. We look at out-of-box experience as UX. So we can think of the simple experience of how a person purchases a product as user experience problem to be solved. So we try to solve LEDs is another one we do, sounds. Everything.
All physical and software interactions a user will have with your product.
Exactly. I mean, we've got products. I mean, Samsung, this is a company that produces like these flagship products. But I've seen products that you go up there and you do a swipe and it will fall over. That's a user experience. Yeah, errors. That's just, you can't sell that product. So it's all about engaging with the product in every single way to find out where you can find some flaws. Or not flaws, but good stuff.
One question, and then I think we'll get around to it.
What do you think is, like, you work with IoT, right? So what do you think is, like, the most difficult thing, I guess, when it comes to working in that area?
Most difficult thing is that it's still a new product. There's this early adoption still. Even though kind of Amazon Alexa has brought it to the mainstream, people still don't know what to do with it. It just kind of sits there, you know, and they get weather. It's a really expensive weather product. I have Echo at home, and I all I do is weather. Okay, and that's the most I do with it. So it's still in the early adoption phase, so we don't know what people really want. They say they want certain things, but reality is they want something completely different. So it's kind of like putting your feelers out, because nobody's gotten it right yet. Like, Google's Nest is kind of doing it, and right, and they got some cool stuff going. Apple's got HomeKit, but they really haven't committed to anything. Nobody's really committed to much. And SmartThings is kind of working its way through, like, the beginning phase. So we have a lot to learn on how IoT will play out in the home. And technology will just get better, and devices will get better. So I think in the next couple of years, we'll start to see it kind of level off to people really want certain things. Right now, cameras are hot. People want cameras. They want security. So security is the number one thing that people are buying IoT for right now. And they haven't gotten into the lifestyle, except for Hue bulbs. Hue's a big one, too. You have a lot of IoT products at home.
Yeah.
Definitely. Do you guys have a lot of IoT at home? Your parents? Have you walked in? Nobody has an echo here?
Two people have echoes.
Like, yeah. Two of us are projects with echoes.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's cool. That's really cool.
So, yeah, we're interfacing some sensors with the echo.
That's awesome. Yeah. And then, what does it do? Does it say something?
Oh, that's funny stuff.
It's in, we've got it, you're Zoom.
But it's like
60 degrees. See, temperature. Yeah. It's the hottest thing right now. Getting the temperature.
So hot.
Echo! What's the temperature? That's cool. That's cool though. I mean, it's Echo. It's you want to be, the smart home wants to tell the user before the user has to engage with it. You don't want to have to engage to know that your house is being flooded. The smart home needs to tell the user, hey, your home's being flooded. You need to get there.
I can't see water.